Thanks, Ian. So I joined Pushpay in 2015, and the year to 31 March 2015, we'd achieved revenue of about $1 million. This year, our guidance is for earnings before interest, tax, depreciation, and FX of 50 to 54 million. So it's been a pretty exciting journey. I'm going to share a little bit of where we came from, a little bit about where we now, where we're heading. So apologies for those of you who have, you know, are more familiar with the story. I'll be going over some old ground, but there's a little bit of question time at the end. I'll jump through slide two, please. We'll take the legals as read and skip on through to slide four. So in terms of our background, I'll go right back to the origin story of the company. There were two young guys, Chris and Elliot, who were both evangelical Christians. They were both looking around for a few business ideas, and they'd had a couple that hadn't panned out. And then one day they were in church. There'd been a cyclone had come through the Pacific Islands. The church is trying to raise money to help with the humanitarian crisis on the ground in Tonga. Plates going around in the church, and they're both sitting there feeling really bad because they want to give. It's a really good cause. But like most Australians and New Zealanders, they're not carrying a checkbook. They don't have a big wad of cash in their pocket. And as the plate comes around, you can't put a credit card through it. So both of them thought, you know, I'll call into the office of the church during the week and I'll give. Then, of course, you get to the office on Monday morning, it's 100 emails, phone calls. And they both later in the week were reflecting on the week and realized that they hadn't made that call and made that gift. And it was then that it hit both of them that this was potentially a good business opportunity, but also an opportunity to increase generosity in the world by effectively making it easier for people to give the amount they want to give. And that key insight has been our core value proposition right through until 2019, when we expanded the value proposition a bit, which I'll talk to. But that idea that for churches, they don't need to convince people to give more money. What they need to do is just reduce the barriers to people giving the amount of money that they want to give. The people feel better because they're being as generous as they want to be, and the church has more money to do the things that they do. And I think one of the things that's hard to pick when you're in Australia or New Zealand, where we have a decent social welfare system, but as examples of some of the initiatives that some of our churches have been taking that we've been talking about in our staff stand-up in the last week, there's a church where the church is funding all of the PPE for paramedics in their community because the local city isn't paying for that. Another one where, you know, the church is paying for a testing station to be run on their grounds. Again, testing has been an issue in the US. So move through to slide five. This one here. So extending that analogy with the ability to give easily, the guys looked at iTunes, and their idea was that they would come up with a solution that was mobile-based and had a great user experience. This really differentiated them in the church space, where most of the products look like something out of the 1970s. And so right from the beginning, their focus was, we're going to make it really easy for people to give, and we're going to make it a really simple user experience. And in fact, it was so simple what we launched with that one of the developers described it to me as it was less an app and more a series of screenshots. It didn't have all of the back office tools that if you're a church administrator, you needed to work out where all these gifts had come from and how they matched up with what was in your bank account. Over time, we've added those capabilities, and we've also added a whole bunch of different ways, which is what's shown on this slide here, for you to interact with the church and to give money. And so if there's any conceivable way that you can give money, you can give it through our platform in that way. And in fact, some Americans give non-cash gifts, and we've built a way to capture that as well. But always our focus is really about trying to bring people to mobile, because our experience has been it's the best user experience for the donor, and it does result in more giving. And as context, some of the work we're seeing now that we acquired a company called Church Community Builder, which is a church management system, and the data we're seeing out of the churches that have Pushpay and Church Community Builder, so we can look back in time, that there are about 12% more giving in those churches than an equivalent church that doesn't have Pushpay. So it really does make a material difference in terms of, we'll talk a little bit about the market size, but in terms of giving you context, some of these churches have revenue of $100 million a year. So we're talking significant value add for the church financially. And in addition to that, we provide benefits in terms of their ability to engage with the church. So on this slide, you'll see that we've got Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. you can't give money via Twitter, but what we originally, and it's still in the App Store, we created a Pushpay app. So the church would go to its members and say, hey, download the Pushpay app so you can give us money. That's a fairly confrontational conversation to have if you don't like talking about money. What we realized in 2015 was that really churches wanted an app of their own, which they could use to communicate with their members. You know, donations would be part of that, but only a part of it. And so in 2015, we launched a white labeled app using a third party app. Subsequently, we bought the rights to some software that allowed it that we've then developed to create what we think is the leading app in the church space. And so that allows churches to effectively deliver everything from they can post their sermons in there, people can watch church live, which obviously with COVID has been a big feature. They can push messages that are customized to the particular individual people in their profile through that app. And so that has been a big change for us. And the link to Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, also YouTube, Vimeo, et cetera, whatever content the church pushes out there by whatever channel, they can choose to link it so that automatically comes through in the app. And certainly if any of you are interested in what our product looks like, then looking at some of those church apps would be worthwhile, and you could contact our investor relations people for a few great examples. But particularly some of the churches with younger demographics are using that app, which is completely in their own branding, to effectively be one of their primary points of engagement with their community. So if we then step through to slide six. So on the left-hand side, This is probably one of the biggest challenges that we have when we talk to people from Australia and New Zealand is trying to get them to get the size of the church market in America. So in 2019, churches in America received donations of $128 million. That's about 40% of New Zealand's GDP. So we're operating in a vertical, but it's a very sizable vertical. And the part that we struggle to get across to people in America is that 15% on the left shows what proportion of giving to churches is estimated. This is all pre-COVID. What proportion of giving to churches in America is estimated to have been done digitally versus through cash and check. And potentially some people are giving everything from RVs to shares, but the bulk of it's going to be cash and check. So for people in Australia and New Zealand, it's obvious to us that everything's going digital because we're already there. New Zealand's pretty much stopped using checks altogether. For people in America, we have debates around, will it get to 50%? Will it get to 60%? We're very clear that it's a question of how long before it gets to 100%, not whether it gets to 100%. And one of the things in the church market is effectively that share of giving that comes digitally is significantly lower than the share of e-commerce transactions generally. So this was this 15% is from a survey of churches by a company called Dunham & Co. As I said, pre-COVID, about 15% of transactions going digitally. We think our churches were probably in the mid-40%, just because we've given them much better tools to make it easier for people to engage digitally with them. And we've seen that continue to grow. So even our oldest groups of customers, even with some loss of, we call it logo churn, so some of the churches leave, even with that, each group of customers for each year continues to grow their revenue. And that's a combination of the churches themselves that we support are typically growing their giving, but also the share that's coming through from digital and therefore across our platform grows. And our revenue model is around a subscription and around effectively a percentage of that revenue that comes through, typically around 2% of every dollar that comes through we keep. So a significant growth driver for us. And obviously one of the big issues with COVID-19 is that has driven a lot of churches to go to stop having in-person services. It's definitely made a lot of people not very keen to handle checks that have been given to them by other people. And so we've seen a jump in that digital share of wallet within our church group. On the right-hand side, just of that $128 billion, in 2019, we had about $5 billion or about 4% of that number come across our platform. So I'll go through to the next slide. So this is just this is sort of like a Gartner magic quadrant type thing. I guess the key call out as a disclaimer is this is our view of the magic quadrant. It's not an independent third party. So it's really trying to plot where we see our competitors. And you'll see in the top left, we've colored the things depending what kind of competitor they are. And so for us, we were, if you like, previously a pure play giving platform. So we were coming to someone a church management system would be effectively like a CRM for a church or an ERP. So think SAP or Salesforce or one of those products, but designed for a church. And so typically those would have some way of giving, including digitally, and would be a key way that the church recorded all of its giving information. So it's got information on its members. Effectively, we're a giving platform. We'd come along and say, hey, your existing giving platform does some of this stuff, but it does it really poorly. It's a terrible user experience. Buy our product. So the people would have to keep paying for the church management system and pick up our product. And as you can see, it also got the white as the pure play app providers. So we effectively were throwing in an app with our giving platform, the idea being that the app helps engagement and get people onto digital. So it effectively drives that increased share of wallet through digital by getting people to get the app on their phone. Eventually, they're going to pick to use the giving functionality in the app as opposed to using cash or check. What we could see was both some efforts by those church management systems to try and improve their giving solutions, but also a lot of customers in the church market are not very sophisticated. And so therefore the complexity of having to integrate those two solutions is a key challenge. So you can see two red dots for Pushpay. The one on the left is without a church management system. The one on the right is with a church management system. So we formed a view that with a church management system, we would be able to deliver that one-stop shop that a lot of customers were looking for, and that would give us more of a lead. And in December last year, we acquired Church Community Builder, which we believe is the leading church management system within our target share portion of the market, which is large and medium churches. And so internally, we call it Better Together, because we can have external branding, but we are finding that we're getting traction with that all-in-one proposition. And we're probably getting it to bigger churches than we'd anticipated. If we jump through to the next slide and through to the next one, so just a few of those numbers. On the left-hand side, processing volume. So you can see that growing significantly over time, up to $5 billion US dollars last year. In the middle, revenue growth. So I talked right about at the beginning of my introduction, $1 million at the beginning. We're $128 million last year. We haven't given guidance on revenue this year. Our focus is on earnings rather than revenue per se. But as you can see, strong growth and that strong correlation of that growth with the growth in processing volume, both as we add new customers, but more importantly, as that share of wallet grows. And then on the right, our EBITDAF as a percentage of operating revenue. So the hypothesis with tech companies, particularly software as a service companies, is that in the beginning, you have a lot of cash burn while you invest in sales and marketing and product development. And then as you add customers, you gain critical scale and you start coming out and generating money. If we extended that graph on the right back, you'd see that in terms of that we were losing money earlier in our existence. The thing that does differentiate us from most other tech companies is we have actually gone through that break-even point and up the other side. And as you can see, we continue to generate significant operating leverage out of our business. We've been able to grow revenue significantly with very little increase in cost other than the costs associated with that processing volume in terms of bank interchange fees, et cetera. So we jump through to the next slide. So one of the big features with COVID-19 was churches had to close. Some places they're reopened. We probably think the majority of our churches are fully closed at the moment. Some are doing some kind of still some in-person services. Definitely been a little bit of I think in that last slide from the previous presentation, it talked about all the uncertainty in America. We see that every day. Definitely for a few months there was it felt like a washing machine of expectations around how many churches were going back to physical services. They were all sort of, particularly the kind of Republican states were all coming out, starting to go back to physical services. And then, then with the surge of COVID back again, it all started going back. So on the right is just an image from one of the, in fact, it's actually from our demo church app. So it gives you some idea of what the app looks like. And as you can see in there, that's a service being run. So a lot of our churches pivoted to using our app to run their services. The other key feature is a little quote there from Satya Nadella saying that COVID-19 has effectively moved people forward a couple of years in digital transformation terms. A lot of you will have seen it with older people picking up Zoom, becoming fans after never having contemplated using it. We're seeing that within our giving with a significant lift in that share of wallet. So those were really the key points I wanted to make.